Hello and welcome to part 6 of creating sports graphics with Boris Continuum. My name is Ben Brownlee with Boris Effects, and it's now time to take a look at the camera. Okay, so this is where we left off with our lighting. We've got our lights spinning around. What we're going to do now is go back into Title Studio and turn this animation completely on its head. Well, not completely on its head. We're actually going to turn it sideways as we start to look at the camera. So we'll come in again into the scene properties and we'll look at the camera tab now. And we have 5 different cameras to choose from. And this can be really useful because we can use some of these cameras to do setups, or alternatively, we can have the same animation, the same 3D animation coming in from multiple angles, which you can then render out all individually and then cut up into one long clip, which is also a nice little technique to use. We're not going to do that in this particular example. We are just going to look at a couple of the camera models instead. So we have 3 different camera models. We have position, where we can just be positioning the camera wherever we want to. We've got, it's basically a free roaming camera. So we've got camera X, Y, Z. We've got a rotation around the camera as well. Or we can do point to target, and we change where the target is, and we basically just come around and do a big sweeping through the target there. That could be quite nice. Or we do point object, which basically does a similar sort of thing. Just lets us zoom around, find out where we're going to, and then zoom around that. We also have pan. So this is just a panning camera. So basically this is just going to pan along left to right, right to left, or we can go and change the distance in and out. Quite a straightforward little model there. So we're just moving the camera back and forth, left and right. We don't have to worry about any sort of rotation. Or the one that we're going to use in this case, which is our orbit mode, where we set a distance that we have from the object, and then we can just rotate around that object like so. And I really like this mode. I like how easy it is to get some nice looking animation with the orbit camera. So this is the one we're going to use. And I'm going to just set this up now. And basically, let's just reset the spin for a second. And basically what we're going to do is we're going to come close. Build that in there. We're going to come close and we're just going to orbit around. Let's come a little bit closer. There we go. And let's set our interpolation around here, and all I'm going to do is just maybe not tumble too much, set our linear on the spin as well, and we're just going to spin around and also come in and rotate around as well. So that's a linear, just bring that up there. We'll adjust the tumble just a wee bit as well. We'll change the spin just a bit as well there. There we go. So it's quite a subtle sort of movement. I kind of like that. I can also make this a little bit more extreme right at the start as we come in. There we go. So it doesn't just lock off. And let's find where. There we go. Let's find here. We'll do an ease in, ease out on this one. There we go. Nice. Now, I also want to come in and start to sort of zoom in on this as well and change the position of the camera, but I'm not going to do that right at this second. I'm going to show you why in just a moment. Let's come to about 6 seconds in. Here we go. Because I want to show you something with the depth of field here. And if I turn on depth of field, we get to simulate depth of field within our camera. So we can choose the focal length and the aperture and the blur size, the number of samples we have here. So these are the important ones. When we have an orbit camera, the focal length is really easy to work out. And it's easy to work out because if we want what's in focus in the middle of the frame, we just set these so that they match together. So that's kind of easy. And this is the reason why throughout the whole of this process, whenever we brought in new models, we've always made sure that the Z position ends up at or very close to zero, and the ball itself is at zero in Z depth, simply because we don't have to worry. Now, if I type this distance the same here, we know that we're going to be exactly in focus on the football in the middle there. So no matter how small my aperture goes, everything else can go out of focus, like a load. I'm still going to have my strip of football in focus there. See, just that little strip there. Obviously, I don't want my aperture that small. Don't want it quite small because I like the look that it gives us, especially with this. And I don't want my blur strength to be that large. Probably 20 there. Now, I said I wanted to animate up the distance, and I do. Now, the interesting thing is I can bring distance here really, really low, but the focal length can actually only go to the smallest value is 2534. So I wanted to focus on anything that's closer than 2534, then I'm out of luck. So what I'm going to do instead, let's just undo that a little bit. So we're back where we sort of started. What I'm going to do instead is I'm going to change my zoom up a little bit. And if I change my zoom up, then I can pull back out here. So my distance is going to be greater, which also means that my focal length is going to be greater. Follow me? Hope so. So now what I can do is come in and actually start to animate this up a little bit. I think when we're here, let's set this to linear to begin with. We'll figure this out in a little bit. Let's bring us in around about there. So after 1 second. And at the beginning, I'm going to zoom us out a little bit. So I'm going to change my distance up to about 6,758. Is that an exact science? Nope. But that's kind of cool. And then I'm going to have a very, very, very slow zoom in as the animation goes forward, ending up around about there. Which means I also might need to change my tumble just a little bit. There we go. Cool. All right, so now I've changed my distance. Guess what that means I need to do if I want to keep everything in focus properly? Yeah, it means I need to keyframe up this focal length as well. So I'm going to come to where my focal length, or sorry, where my distance keyframe is, which is here. And I'm going to change this to ease in, ease out, because I'm also going to change the distance to ease in, ease out. Come to the end frame where I've also got the keyframe there. And set this to 3475. That should bring that nicely into focus again. There we go. Now, some other stuff that we can do with the camera, as well as changing up the sample size for the blur strength, is we can also change up things like the gain. So check out what's happening to the highlights. As I bring the gain up, we're starting to get little blowouts on the highlights as well. So this can be quite useful if we've got quite a high threshold here. As we blur this out, let's take our threshold down just a wee bit. As we blur that out, we can actually get some nice sort of highlights, natural highlights happening as we get the extreme blur. I don't want to go too heavy on this, because I really don't want to blow out all of these big areas. What we've also got is we've also got fringe. So this gives us some nice chromatic aberration as well, as we've got the blur. So if I turn that up really high, you can check out we've got tons of chromatic aberration where the bits are moving and losing focus. So that fringe can look really nice. And give us a bit of fringe. Like that. I want to make sure that I don't hit the football too much there. And I can even change the lens shape. So make it a pentagon shape instead. Just zoom in to 200% so you can actually see what this is doing. Check out what's happening on the blur type there. So we've got a round blur. Turn the pentagon shape on. We get a pentagon blur instead with feathering that we can adjust up and down as well. Actually, we'll zoom that to fit again. There we go. Okay, and that blur strength is way too high now. Let's turn the blur up just a little bit. With 33, that's still quite a lot, but I like how that's looking. And we take a look at this from above. Take a look at the top view and check out what's happening to our camera. Spinning around, we get a really nice, complex looking camera move, really with just a couple of keyframes. You know, that's going to look nice, I think. Great, so now I have the camera set up with the depth of field, all of that fun stuff. Now comes the time to render it. So we've got a few other options in our render tab that are going to be useful for us. We've got the final quality level, which currently is set to better. If we set this to best, it's just going to aid in with a few of the anti-aliasing areas. Let's see if I've got a good, let's just pan around here. Take a look at this area here. So if I do basic, you know, those textures aren't looking particularly great. I do good. Starts to fix those up a little bit. Better, even nicer, best. It's getting a really nice shape there. If we have lots of transparent areas intersecting each other, we can have better transparent intersections turned on. In this case, we actually don't have transparent areas intersecting too much. I think we've only got one transparent ring or semi-transparent ring, so I'm happy to leave that off, save the processing time. And we can also enable motion blur here. Now, if you're using this in Avid or Premiere or Resolve, then you want to enable motion blur at this stage. You're going to want to add in that motion blur just to get it looking nice. Now, adding in motion blur will obviously increase render times a bit, but let's take a look at what we get instead. Let's fit this to 100%, bring us to around about here, where we're starting to get a little bit more in focus. So probably we can see that a bit better. So motion blur off, all of these stars looking very, very sharp. Motion blur on, and eventually we're getting a sort of natural smoothness going on here. I could even actually add a bit of rotation to that ring there and get it looking really nice as well. And we can increase the shutter angle here. So the higher the shutter angle, the more motion blur we see apparent in the image. And we can change the smoothness from low, medium, high, and highest. So this controls the number of samples that it takes. Having higher sample rate, so setting this up to the highest, it's going to give a smoother motion blur, but also it's going to take longer to process out. In After Effects, we don't have to have motion blur enabled here. And we'll see why. It's going to hit apply. Go before, let it have a little think, and that's the after. The reason why we don't have to have motion blur turned on in Title Studio is because we can use the comp motion blur. So we can have motion blur that matches the rest of the composition. So if I go to composition settings and go into our advanced here, you can see that I've already got this motion blur set up to be a very high shutter angle. 360 with a shutter phase of minus 180. Very high samples per frame. Let's take this down to 16. Actually, let's take this down to 8 because I want to show you something. And the adaptive sample going on there. So with comp motion blur turned on, I turn the motion blur on here. After Effects is going to automatically turn on motion blur up here with CC 2019. And let's find an area where we've got some a good amount of motion blur. So motion blur off. Motion blur on, off, on, off, on. And I'm going to zoom in a little bit on this because you can start to see with a low number of samples, you can actually see the samples popping in here. And I see this quite a lot, even with broadcast graphics, is where someone's, you know, they've probably run up against a little deadline or just forgotten to change the setting, but you can really see like the stepping in the motion blur. And it's something that actually, you know, annoys me a little bit. Take a look at this here. I'm going to turn the samples per frame up and change it to 32. This is, again, quite a large number. The default is 16, where you can still see the stepping on faster moving images. But at 32, all of that stepping just disappears and we are left with this really, really nice, smooth motion blur. So motion blur off, motion blur on, off, and on. You know, it makes a big difference. It also makes a big difference to render times, but that's by the by. If you're looking for quality, sort your motion blur out. Get it looking nice. Cool, and I think I'm ready to render this out now. We're not finished with this spot, not by a long shot. But if we try to work on with this as it is now and just keep layering stuff on top and more stuff and more stuff and more stuff, we're already asking it to do quite a lot. So it's going to be quite slow anyway. So by rendering this out, doing a little pre-render, I'm going to save myself a ton of headaches down the line. Now, the only thing that I need to remember to do is to render this out to a format that supports an alpha channel. If I don't, then I'm going to be in troubles. So choose your favorite codec that supports an alpha channel. In this case, I'm going to just send this over to the media encoder. I'm going to choose Apple ProRes 444444. There we go, with alpha channel. You know, and the ability to render out directly to Apple ProRes straight out of Adobe Media Encoder has been an absolute godsend. And I'm going to render this out. I've got my little thing, it's called pre-renders. I'm going to call this one Ben Ring Animation with Camera 01. So I'm going to keep this as a very different name to the other naming convention that I've already got. And I'm going to render this out. I'm going to take a little break. I suggest you do as well. And when we come back in part 7, we're going to see that this render isn't the last thing that we do to make it look really, really nice. We're going to start bringing in some other effects over the top of this rendered comp. And we're also going to create up a quick and lovely looking motion background as well using particle illusion. But that's all coming up in part 7. So while I hit render now, grab a cup of coffee, grab a cup of tea, grab a biscuit, and I will see you on the other side. Thanks for watching. And be sure to go to borisfx.com to download a free trial of Boris Continuum so you can try this out yourselves. If you want to see more of this type of tutorial or you have some ideas of your own, be sure to leave a comment below. Also, subscribe to the Boris YouTube channel to stay up to date with the latest information and training materials on all the Boris FX products.